non-subjective viewpoint, it's more like a big ball of wibbly-wobbly, timey-wimey stuff.
What a rush. Well, what an attractive looking audience you are, I must say. Good afternoon, everybody. Hello, yes. Very, very nice to see all of you here. I actually do recognize a couple of faces here from TechEd. My name is Andy Malone. I'm an MVP in enterprise security. I'm from Scotland, not England. I'd just like to point that out. Thank you very much. And I'm going to be here talking today about cybercrime, the ultimate survival guide for 2014. Okay? And you guys look like people that might need a survival guide for cybercrime. So that's what we're going to talk about today. So. Hopefully you'll agree with it. Some of them you may not agree with. Now, what I always do after my sessions, I like to give a little bit of love. So I'm going to share a SkyDrive. So if you like the videos that I'm showing, I've got some tools that I'm going to mention, all my PowerPoints, everything. The gotcha is, though, that you've got to sign up to my Twitter account, okay? And you can sign up to me at Andy Malone. So if you go to Twitter, sign up at Andy Malone. I'm going to post probably either later on this evening, depending on how much I drink, or tomorrow. I will actually go ahead and post those extras for you. So I am Andy Malone. I'm from the UK. I'm a specialist in cybercrime and cybersecurity. I do a lot of work with military and also governments worldwide. So from the United Arab Emirates to South Africa to North America to Germany to the UK. If you happen to be going to TechEd this year, then TechEd, of course, is in Houston in Texas in May. And it will be great to see you, and you can definitely buy me a drink there. Just a joke there. Or alternatively, if you're going to go to the European TechEd, then you can see me in October in Barcelona, which sounds very nice, doesn't it? Yes. Definitely. A few years ago, they did it in Berlin in December. It was very cold. So Barcelona in October sounds pretty good to me. Okay, so we are, as Barack Obama, he basically said, you know Barack Obama, he's popular here, right? the cyber, almost as popular as George Bush, but we won't go into that. So what we have here is the cyber threat is probably one of the greatest threats that we've seen in a long time. Now, that little video that I showed you at the beginning there, that is amazing. That's what we've accomplished in just over 100 years. That's incredible. Albert Einstein once said, you know, the planet doesn't change. Planet Earth doesn't change. Only our ideas change. And certainly this week, or these next couple of days, you're going to see some pretty amazing things. Andre was showing you Windows Azure earlier. That's pretty cool stuff. But obviously, with good stuff comes bad stuff as well. So when we start talking about cyber threats, what are my favorite cyber threats at the moment? So this is Andy's favorite cyber threats for 2014. So coming in definitely at number 10 is the social networking cyber threat. So who's on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn? Who's on one of those? Raise your hand. It's okay, nobody's taking a picture of you. You can be honest. Okay, yes, who's on Twitter, LinkedIn, Facebook? Yes, of course you are, of course you are. You're all sociable people. Yes, you look very sociable people. Okay, so who's got kids? Who's got kids at home? Okay, I bet you're a little bit wary of them going on social networks, right? Yes, of course you are. And quite rightly too. In my opinion, my daughter has got, she's got this, what's the photo one? It's not Facebook. What's the other one? Thank you, Instagram. Yes, thank you. Oh, Instagram, okay. Instagram is owned by Facebook. And an interesting story to tell you. I was delivering a session at TechEd last year in New Orleans, and this guy came up to me. Did you know, by the way, that anything that you post on a public social network, so Facebook, LinkedIn, one of those sites, anything that you post is their property. They own it. They own the rights to it. They own the rights to copy it, publish it, broadcast it, whatever they want. It basically becomes public. And this guy came up to me and he said, you know, that's funny you should say that, Andy. I just got off a flight to Disney World in Orlando. And I got to the theme park, and on the bus was a picture of my two kids. Isn't that crazy? Absolutely crazy stuff. So when we talk about the... Stalk, that's the right word, actually. When we talk about social networking, it's interesting that, you know, just a few years ago, you guys would have gone down to the pub, bar, whatever you guys call it here, and you would have consumed a little bit of alcohol. Ladies, you might have gone to a fashionable coffee shop with your friends. But now we don't do that. Now we just sit in our bedrooms Twittering or Facebooking and so on. And, you know, it's just a little bit creepy. Don't you find that when Facebook comes up and it says, hey, these are a few people that you might know. And you go, how do you know that? It is that Facebook is one of the most sinister pieces of software I've seen in a long time. Very, very sinister. So we're now what we call the socio-technical society. So the technio-social society. The idea of this is we no longer talk to people. We now, you know, text, you know. Have you seen the kids today? You know, lordy, wow. My fingers never move that fast on a keyboard. So this is becoming a real threat. And I'm not just talking about, obviously, the threat of... it's not just about friends. So I actually did some research for the US military recently. And the military were basically saying, hey, we don't want our soldiers going on Facebook. So we're going to ban them going on Facebook. And I'm saying my argument against that is how can you, it's not revolution, it's evolution. This is evolution. It's something you can't stop. And with evolution, you can maybe try and control it, you can manage it, but you can never stop it. Okay, it will just happen. And another thing about this particular problem, the definite lack of regulatory control. I mean, who's controlling Facebook? Who's controlling Twitter, LinkedIn? Okay, these products sit in a US data center. Okay, it's all their laws, all their restrictions. And it's not just about numbers anymore. You know, I was asking the kids in a school, you know, how many friends have you got on Facebook? Oh, I've got 10, I've got 20, I've got 100. I've got 1,300. How can anybody have 1,300 friends? Okay? Some of you are looking maybe if you've got two. Okay, how can you have 13? It's impossible. And the thing, it's not just about numbers because you don't know them. So here, I can see all of you. We can talk to each other. We can shake hands. But out there in cyberspace, you don't know these people. And it's not just kids either. It's adults as well. Stalking, cyber stalking is becoming a real problem. So cyberbullying is something that's becoming a real problem as well at school. So in years ago, you know, everybody's been bullied. Everybody's been, you know, when you were kids. But now that's gone to a new level. So cyberbullying now goes online. Yes, they now start posting. So what was maybe between two or three people can potentially be between 2,000 or 3,000 people. And you can imagine that would be quite distressing for kids and families. And in fact, it's seen a massive rise in suicide, child suicide. And not just the US, not just Europe, it's worldwide. This is a worldwide phenomenon. So this is something that we need to address as parents, as teachers, and as responsible adults as well. So cyberbullying is a real issue. And maybe the law needs to be changed. Now this little girl here, Jessica Linehart, very nice young lady. Well, she's a little bit wild, as you'll see. She's got the screen name of Jesse Slaughter. This is a very, very famous case in the US. And basically, she went on and she threatened. She made a little YouTube video threatening her friends. And this thing just went global. And all the cyber criminals, all the networks, they all basically piled on top of her and her family. You can imagine somebody ordering you a Chinese food or a pizza delivery. But when it's 500 pizza deliveries a day, it doesn't become funny anymore. This girl was being harassed, and actually she was taken off her parents because of the problems. Anyway, this is the result of that. We got a little video here. Volume, please.
You know what?
To say that you guys have ruined my life.
I'm going
to
tell you right now. This is from her father. You bunch of lying, no good punks. And I know who it's coming from because I've backtraced it. And I know who's emailing and who's doing it. And you've been reported to the cyber police and the state police.
Right.
So you better write one more thing or screw with my computer again. You'll be arrested. End of conversation from her father. And if you come near my daughter, guess what? Consequences will never be the same. You lying bunch of pricks.
See, my house has been like this. Ever since everybody's been posting stuff about me, okay? I am personally torn. I am literally, I have been having emotional breakdowns one after another for the past, like, 3 days.
You can't sleep, you can't eat.
You guys are just basically tearing me apart right now. I'm crying my eyes out if you haven't noticed that. Please, stop hating. You have to ruin my fucking life.
It's pretty sad. It's funny when you see it initially, but then you realize, hang on a minute, she's only 11. And that's happening to kids all over the world. And many of them are ending in suicide. I think it's time that that changes. So parents need to be more responsible. The kids are more knowledgeable about this stuff than you guys. Remember, this is a generation that's growing up with this stuff. Okay? We're catching up compared to these kids. So when we talk about safety, cyber safety, we need to be aware of some, obviously, the dangers out there. And I do a full presentation on this, by the way. You can, if you go to Channel 9 on the Microsoft website, Tech Ed Channel 9 videos, I do an entire presentation on this. If anybody needs the link, I can post the link, and there's a whole presentation. So if you've got kids, you may want to show them that video. So how can you avoid it? Obviously, definitely avoid mixing personal and professional. So the last thing that you want to do is you don't want a potential employer to go onto Facebook seeing you throwing up on a Saturday night. That's definitely something that you don't want. So if you're going to go onto Facebook, you've got to be very careful what you post. Likewise, if you're on multiple social networks, don't be stupid. Don't use the same password, the same login for all of them. So if somebody's going to steal your identity, which I would never do, but if you're going to steal somebody's identity, that makes it so much sweeter. So just be aware of that. And be very, very careful. I call it the trigger finger. Be careful what you say. Be careful what you post. It may come back and bite you. And it could cost you dearly. So just, you know, good advice. So, moving on. Number 9 in my list is the famous distributed denial of service attack. Okay, this very, very simple attack, it's been around for many, many years. And to be honest, it's just something that won't go away. Okay, it definitely won't go away. And the thing is, the software is so simple to get. Buy the software. You don't even need to buy it. You can just get it. It's available anywhere. So essentially, a denial of service attack, as you can see here, is you just basically where you completely overwhelm the bandwidth of servers. And as a result, of course, it crashes them down. So there are a number of classic cases. So Spamhaus, Bitcoin, WordPress, CNN, the list just goes on. So the idea is that you basically have such a crowd here, so you can imagine going to a football game. So if you go to a football game and there's only one gate to get through, it's just absolutely crazy. So sooner or later, it's going to be a denial of service attack. So it's still a classic attack. Now, what can you do? Well, you don't even need to buy the software anymore. Okay, you'll see a little bit later on, I'm talking about the dark side of the internet. There are now hosting sites. So if you're thinking of, you know, just bringing down your local school web server with a little piece of software, you could pretty much do that. But these guys have the power of huge data centers behind them. So these guys can do some real damage, okay? All for the price of about $100 for 15 minutes. So they will just completely bombard your target for 15 minutes for $100. That's just crazy. So, how can you mitigate this type of attack? Well, there's no silver bullet for this. It's actually quite difficult. But one of the most basic things that you can do is you can initiate DNSSEC, DNS security. So that if DNS requests are coming in, then at least you can verify them that they're coming from genuine sources. And again, DNSSEC has been around for quite some time now. It's been around since Windows Server 2008, 2008 R2 and above. So you've got really no excuse. You can enable it, you can switch it on. It's actually much better in 2012 and 2012 R2 as well. So when we talk about, I'll just show you some of the software. So when we talk about DNSSEC, let's have a look. So what we've got, this is the most famous one probably. This is LOIC, Low Orbit Ion Cannon, okay? It's a great name. Can you see this? No, you can't see that. Let's just go here. There we go, okay. So this is LOIC, and basically all you need to do here, this can either be a host IP address, or it can be a URL, so a website URL, and you can basically perform a classic denial of service attack through this, and all you do is just go attack. Forgive me, I do want to actually get home from Ukraine, although Ukraine is very nice. I do actually want to get back to Scotland, so I'm not going to perform that live, if you don't mind. another one, there are a couple of these that I can show you. Another good one is, and if you'll excuse the name of the product, Evil Fokker. Okay. Oops, right, we'll just go for this one. Yeah, we'll do this one. Oh, it's because I've switched my internet off. Switch it back on. Okay, so this is a nice little piece of software. You can perform man-in-the-middle attacks, denial of service attack, both for IPv4 and IPv6. And you can also do some pretty good DNS hijacking. Now, I'm not suggesting for 1 minute that you guys would use this for anything bad. Okay, I'm not suggesting that. What I am suggesting is that you guys would probably use this as a legitimate network testing tool. Yes, I think so, yes. So this is a great little tool, Evil Fokker. Okay, I will put these in downloads for you guys, and you guys, you know, by the time I'm on a plane anyway, I'll be okay, so. So, just a little bit of denial of software. So, as I said, mitigation, pretty much DNS security is the key here. You need to implement DNSSEC. It's free, it's available, not just on Microsoft servers, of course, it's available on different platforms as well. Disable things like recursion, only use authoritative name servers, good advice, and again, that's the way to move forward. So, Andy's number 8. So, in at number 8. How safe is my stuff in the cloud? Okay, do you feel that your stuff is safe in the cloud? Maybe, yes. Okay, actually, to be fair, I'm an MVP. I'm not a Microsoft employee. So a tagline of an MVP is real world answers. I can be truthful, okay? Would I trust my stuff in the cloud? Okay, to be fair, if it was a public cloud, you know, one of those free ones that you get, could you turn my microphone down just a touch, please? Thank you. If it's one of those free ones that you get, you know, things like Facebook and all of that stuff, absolutely not. I wouldn't trust it as far as I could throw it. But when you go to Microsoft and, you know, you get what we call you get an agreement, basically, that says, yeah, we guarantee. And that they basically hold your stuff on different servers. So it's completely separate from the DROS that's out there. Okay, so your stuff is safe. And they would never sell it on. Is that right, Andrew? No. Okay. That's what he tells me anyway. And is it secure? I mean, you know, Office 365, does that mean it'll never go down? Why do you think they never give you 100% guarantee? Tell me that. Yes? Microsoft, Google, Amazon, they'll all give you this 99.9%. It's called a service level agreement. Why will they never say 100%? It's impossible. Only God could give you those kind of numbers. Okay? It's impossible to give you 100%. So what they'll do, they'll say, hey, 99.9%, we guarantee at that uptime. And is Microsoft any better than anybody else? They're all pretty much the same, to be honest. They're all pretty much doing a good job, okay? Except for Google, of course. Google are going into robots now. Now they're starting Terminators. Okay, you can buy a new Terminator. That'll be cool. I'll be back. Hasta la vista. Okay, so as a business, do not rely on free services, okay? You can't rely on that stuff. Because do you know why? You've heard of SkyDrive, sorry, OneDrive, yes? They keep changing the name of it. Yes, you know OneDrive, yes? Who uses OneDrive? Who uses that? Yes? Of course you do, because you're loyal Microsoft customers. Okay, of course you are. So, and you know you've got the desktop synchronization products, you know that, yes? You know where you can sync your files to the local desktop? Do you know why that came out? Because in the European Union, if you were a private cloud provider, one of the laws is that you must provide backup facilities of the data. And in OneDrive, because it was a free product, it says we do not guarantee backup. So to guarantee the backup, they provided a synchronization device which allowed you to make a local backup copy. And that was because of European law. And that's where the OneDrive sync product came from. Bet you didn't know that, did you? Okay. So always back up your data. Always scrutinize the vendors as well. And if you're going to sign up to a cloud service, for goodness sake, at least, especially in a government or a health authority, a college, a university, there's lots of different departments. And in lots of different departments, you know, we'll sign up to this and we'll sign up to that. And it's very, very easy to lose control of this stuff. So if you're going to do that, have a central point, have a central policy for signing up, because that's the way that you control and you can maintain your data. I call it the seven deadly sins, ignorance. So make sure that you know what you're signing up for. Ambiguity, agreeing to contracts that you have no idea what they mean. Who reads the SLA, the service level agreements from Microsoft? You know, who reads those terms and conditions when you install a Microsoft product? Go on, admit it. Who reads it? Nobody. Lawyers do, yes. That's right. Lawyers do. I'm not going to read all of these because you can read these yourselves later. Complacency. Don't be complacent about when you're purchasing a cloud service. Okay? You know, you need to know where your data is. And that's at least one good thing for Microsoft. Now, I have no idea here. Microsoft in the Ukraine, when you sign up to Azure and Office 365, where does your data go? Sorry? Oh, somewhere in the cloud. Okay. Where does it get? Right, well, for example, I live in the UK, right? And in the UK, because of a European law, all data in the European Union, it goes into the Irish, into Dublin, into the Dublin data center, and it's replicated to Amsterdam, yes? And the idea is that you get backups there. Is it the same? It's the same, Okay, so, yeah, okay. Somebody at the side of Andre going, say it's the same. Okay. Okay. And that's fine, because you need to know where your data is. So what I'm saying is your data then doesn't flow through the United States. Okay? Now, on saying that, that might be a bad thing. You know, if you lose your data in the United States, at least you can phone up the NSA and go, excuse me, I've lost some data. Any chance of getting it back, please? Okay? Okay. So, just a quick look at some of the security features in the cloud. So what are some of the things that you can do in the cloud? So this is Office 365. I'm going to go just very quickly into my Exchange Admin Center here. Oh. I'm actually showing something. That's Bergen, I'll have you know. It's a very nice place. So here we are. This is the Exchange Admin Center. And I've been teaching Office 365 now for quite a while. And this particular version is really kind of, okay, we really need to do a lot for security now. So what we're seeing here is we're seeing the fact that you've got this thing called compliance. One of the things that I kind of specialize in is forensics. I do a lot of digital forensics with customers. So things like this, in-place e-discovery, auditing, data loss prevention is fantastic. So, you know, if you're sending out an email and you're putting in a credit card number, you can put a little policy that pops up and goes, you know, I really don't think you want to start putting credit card numbers in emails, okay? That's a good thing. Well, that's not a good thing to do. So, you know, in that respect, it's actually really good. Retention policies. So how long are you actually going to keep your data for? Okay, assuming, of course, you pay your fees to Microsoft. Because that's the bit that they got to mention, by the way. So you can basically keep, you know, if it's financial data, if it's legal data, then I'm sure the Ukraine is pretty much the same as everybody else. You've got to keep your data for a certain amount of time. And this will help you do that. Okay. I'm going to talk a little bit about, a little bit more about this tomorrow when I do my Office 365 session. Okay? Oh, another thing I wanted to mention. Keeps flipping back. I'm just going to go into Microsoft's favorite search engine. And, sorry. Come on. Who uses Bing? Jesus. Hey, they do nice pictures, okay? I'll be honest, come on. They do great products. Microsoft do great products, but they just, sorry, Bing, no. Now it's like Windows Millennium all over again. So if I do a Bing search, okay, if I typed in CNN, okay, what is Google? What is Google? Shout it out. A search engine. What can it search? Everything. Okay? I'll ask you this question later, but I'll ask you now. What is the dark web? Have you heard of this term, the dark web? Basically, it's a website that Google can't find. It's dark, yes. Okay, so everybody just uses Google for this, but you can do some pretty cool stuff with Google. Okay, so I can say, hey, I want to search a site. Let's say I'll search, let's say com, and I'll say, okay, I want to search for file type, and I'll say, let's say XLS, and I'll say, I know I'm doing this in English, I apologize. My Ukrainian is terrible. so membership list, okay? And this is essentially what they call an advanced Google search or Google hacking. So you can search for open webcams. That can be fun, by the way. Okay? You can search for web servers, printers, HP laser printers that have got web servers built in, and then you start printing lots of stuff. It's a lot of fun. Not that I would ever do that, you understand. So you can see here that we've got XLS, so we've got spreadsheets here. Now, nobody would be stupid enough to put this stuff on the internet, right? Surely not. Oh, look, there is. Okay. That's a little silly, isn't it? But what makes it even a little bit more fun is when you do this. Now, nobody would be this stupid, would they? Oh, there is. Yes, well, I won't open that because I don't want a black van to be waiting for me when I get outside. But actually, if you want a little bit of fun, by the way, you want to get this little tool. I mentioned Evil Fokker. This is just Fokker. Sorry, if you're recording this on video, I'm sorry. If you're recording this on video, that's Ukrainian for biscuit, okay? Okay, so I'm going to open up this little tool. And let's just... And this is interesting. So what I'm doing here, as you can see, I'm doing a search, sterling.gov. I live in Stirling in Scotland, okay? So gov is the government website. And I'm saying, okay, I want to search for all PDF files. So this does a massive search of the entire servers. Okay, oop, right, okay. Okay, so there we go. And it will just look on the government server, and it will just pull off every PDF that it sees. Okay, so we can just let that go and go and go. Now, I'll just stop that, because now what we can do, and this is where it gets very fun, I can right-click here, I can say, okay, I want to download all of these documents at once. So I can just bring them all down. So it's kind of an automated Google hack here. And now what I'm going to do is I'm now going to extract all the metadata from those files. Okay, so not only have I now got the PDFs, I've also got a list of users and usernames from that company. You could have printer. I've got what software they're using. Office 95, are you kidding me? Goodness sake. It must be a government body, yeah. Okay, so you see what I mean? So if I was a hacker, if I was a hacker, okay, I would now know potential vulnerabilities that these guys could have, all right? So there we go. That's Fokker. Great piece of software. Okay. So moving back. Okay, so next thing then is if you're going to put stuff out there, if you're going to put it in the cloud, like spreadsheets, PDFs, Word documents, how can you protect that? So you can use this. This is rights management. So I'm going to go into Office 365 here, and you can see I'm going to activate rights management services here. So, yep, I'm just going to activate that. Now I'm going to a document here in Word. Now that it's been switched on, all I need to do is just go and say, hey, I want to protect this document. So I'm restricting access to this document only for internal members of staff. Okay? So only for internal. So now if I go and send somebody this document that is outside the organization and just attach this to it, Sure enough, the document will go. And even if this is on a website, it could be absolutely anywhere. So just attach the document. Bring that in and fire that off. So if you're an external user, a public user, if you're on a website, if you do a Google search, just like I did, and when you get this document, so I'm logging on as that other user, and I'm going to open up this document, boom, it now says, I'm sorry, you don't have the rights to do this because it's encrypted into the document. Rights Management Service is a free service. You should be using it. Seriously, it can protect you. Okay, it's a fabulous little tool. Number 7 in my list. How are we doing for time? We're okay. Not the activist, the hacktivist. Okay, Anonymous. Yes? Any members of Anonymous here? I asked that in Dublin and everybody put their hands up. Okay. Irish. No. So, the rise of the hacktivist. Interesting thing about these guys is they're not money motivated. They're not even politically motivated. This is nothing to do with money or politics or religion. It's to do, is it morally right? Are we doing the moral thing here? So what these guys tend to do, and actually they do a pretty good job. They do a pretty good job of hunting down pedophiles, for example. Hunting down known cyber criminals and making your life hell. But the problem with Anonymous is what? You have no idea who they are, okay? A, it could be law enforcement people are doing it. It could be government people that are doing it. It could be part of some military operation. The problem with this is that these guys are very noble. They do a good thing sometimes. But again, it's all down to things like plausible deniability. So if you were a member of Anonymous or LUTSEC or one of those other groups, the idea is that you work together as one. Present a unified voice. So Anonymous France is the same as Anonymous Ukraine, is the same as Anonymous UK, and so on. So this is essentially what they stand for. And when you look at that, you think, you know, that's pretty good. That's pretty noble. But the problem with being Anonymous is that you have no power, you have no punch. Whereas if you came together as a potential political party, let's say, at least then you've got a face and people can relate to that. Also, it's heavily monitored by law enforcement. So again, it's actually driven what was a pretty noble cause. It's kind of driven it underground now. And it's a bit of a shame. Another big one as well is plausible deniability. So if I go and attack the North Koreans, their website, bring their servers down, wasn't me. I don't know anything about it. Prove it. Plausible deniability. Okay. And the problem is, when does the activist or the hacktivist, what's that tipping point? We call this the tipping point. You know, where you're prepared to go from good guy to bad guy. And it's just a very short step. Is that human nature? Maybe. Number 6. The Snowden effect. Okay, who's heard of Edward Snowden? Okay, spy. Yes, he's a spy. Yes. Okay. Yeah. Apparently he's enjoying the sunshine in Moscow. Did you know, and I don't know if you knew this, he has just become rector. Now, rector is the word in Scotland for head teacher of Glasgow University. This is true. Yes? The students of Glasgow University get to choose their rector by vote. and they voted Edward Snowden as their rector for 2014. And so, of course, he now delivers all his speeches through Skype, okay? Which is, you know. Okay, so Edward Snowden, of course, revealed classified NSA secrets of a global surveillance program. Now, yeah, okay, we knew of that the NSA's got a global surveillance program. Of course they do. But the scale of what he revealed had never been done before in human history. Okay? Never before on this scale. Show of hands. Who thinks he was a good guy? Did he do the right thing? Was he a good guy? A few. Some of you are going, make sure nobody's looking at me. Do you think he was a bad guy to do that? Who thinks he was a bad guy? Me. The one person that puts their hand up and goes. Okay. So. Now, I want to show you this, right? I started putting a slide together for you guys, okay? And I thought, okay, September 12th, you know, after September 11th. And I gave up, and this is the reason why. This was the slide. Can you see this? So this is the Bill of Rights, December 16, 1791. So these are all the US laws in terms of surveillance and privacy since the United States was born, right? So 1791, okay, there's not many. Ooh, look at that, 1975. So only two between 1791 and 1975. 1978, so there's a few now. Now we go September the 11th. So this is the attacks on the World Trade Center. Now check this out. These are all the different acts, all the different laws, spying laws that have come into, and it keeps going. And that's just 2001. Then we get into 2002. And it keeps going, keeps going, keeps going. In fact, it keeps going and keeps going and keeps going. Isn't that just incredible? Wow. I think that's just incredible. Crazy Americans. Okay, now, poor old Angela here, she's had a rough time, hasn't she? Oh, she has. What about privacy? But it's okay. Barack says, don't worry, honestly, we never monitored you. No, really, honestly, I promise. And then, then it's like, and then I told her we wouldn't bug her a phone. Okay, so, but then you might argue, I love that picture, by the way. You might argue, but what have I got to hide? Silvio, of course, he's got lots to hide. He's a one for the ladies, this man. And you might argue that I've got nothing to hide. No, you have something to hide, my friends. And if you go to the Utah data center, this is the NSA's data center, which has just opened in Utah in the United States. And it says there, it says, if you have nothing to hide, you have nothing to fear. What about liberty, justice, privacy, the Fourth Amendment of the United States? Wow, are you just going to rip that up and throw that away? Okay. president of Brazil, she said, if there is no right to privacy, then there can be no true freedom of expression and therefore no true democracy. That's a great saying. Okay? And things look like they're starting to change in the US now, so hopefully. So, in at number five, how are we doing? We're doing good. We're doing good for time. State-sponsored crime. I had a slide in here before. Cyber criminals, the bad guys. You know, some of you might be sat there. Me? some of you, you know, there might be some in the audience. You're irrelevant now. You're the small guys. These guys are the big guys. Okay? GCHQ, the NSA, the US military, they now have full cybercrime divisions. State-sponsored cybercrime is now taking place on an industrial scale. Okay? So companies are doing it. Governments are doing it. The Chinese and the Americans have this little tit-for-tat thing going on. Okay? Here's a question. In all the world, who produces most spyware? China. Who says China? Raise your hand if you say China. Okay? Actually, it's the Americans. That's true. That's true. Okay. So, state-sponsored cybercrime. So, whether you're infiltrating an Iranian nuclear facility or stealing secret plans to Japanese submarines, this happens all the time, okay? Mitigation. How can you mitigate this type of attack? To be honest, these are professionals. So, Stuxnet, for example, had a $10 million price tag. $10 million to produce a piece of malware. It was professionally. Now, it had two genuine Microsoft certificates. So, did somebody steal those certificates? Because Microsoft say, hey, we don't know anything about that. Did somebody steal them? Or were they given to them? Conspiracy theories, I think. Number four. Cyber warfare. Actually, we don't like cyber warfare anymore. But cyber warfare can be anything from Egyptians, you know, we don't like what the people are saying, let's switch off the internet. That's cyber warfare. Okay? Disruption of network traffic. One of the reasons why the Americans, well, sorry, apparently the Americans, delivered Stuxnet with Israel, we won't mention that. One of the reasons that they did it was in order to save lives. So press a couple of buttons over here, try and disrupt over here electronically, saves sending people in on the ground, to be fair. So this is a big business, of course. Attacks can include espionage, national security breaches, sabotage, denial of service attacks. Hospitals, however, and medical units are protected under an agreement between NATO and the Eastern Bloc. Possible scenarios for cyber warfare include power grid disruption, internet communications, air traffic control, water. Why are those ones in red, by the way? Sorry? The most important, yes. Any other reasons why you think those ones are in red? They could kill people. Yes, they can affect human life. That's right. Okay. In at number three, a game of phones. Okay? So, PCs are yesterday. Okay, I'm sorry, Microsoft. Okay, they're so 1970s, okay? Okay, the world is moving on. There's new attack platforms now. And whether you've got, obviously everybody slags off Android. Even Microsoft have got a new Android phone coming out shortly. And the problem is Android malware. Yes, Android malware is a little bit of a problem. However, it's only a problem if you use jailbreak, if you jailbreak your phone. In other words, you don't want to pay for stuff. Okay? So if you don't want to pay for stuff, that's fine, but you don't pay your money, you take your chance. Okay? Which is fair enough. So just beware of that. Mitigation. Always use a PIN number. I know that sounds stupid, but did you know that 42% of people don't put a PIN code on their phones? Do you believe that? Don't use jailbreak phones. Always install antivirus on your mobile device, your Microsoft Surface device, your iPad, whatever you've got. Consider subscribing to a phone tracking service. There's some really good ones out there, and they're free, some of them. Implement phone security. So, for example, if you're using Microsoft Exchange, Exchange Server, Office 365, you've got remote wipe capabilities built in. The same with BlackBerry, Apple, and so on. There's no such thing as a free lunch, so only download from reputable sources, the game store or whatever it is you're downloading. Again, I've just mentioned those. Last year's number one is now this year's number two, the one rotten apple. What am I talking about? You, human beings. Yes, because without human beings, we'd have no cybercrime. Okay? Now, here's a question for you. And I want you to think long and hard about this question. If I had a nice little leather bag here with $1 million in it, think about it. Think about that. $1 million. Think about what that could do for you. That's a new life. You know, you could send your kids to a private school for a week, maybe. Depends on how expensive it is here. I don't know. Now, the question is, I need you to take a file from your server. Question is, would you do it? Uh-huh. See? Yeah. It's human nature. So, actually, I'm surprised nobody said it. Somebody always comes back and says this. Is there any more? Can you up it a bit? And I'll think about it. Okay. So, human beings are the weakest link. There is no excuse. So, ignorance is no excuse. Some of the reasons that people do it, the fear factor. They're coerced into doing it. Okay. I've been involved with a number of cases where we've seen coercion. Don't be too social, as I said. You know, some of you guys, when that beautiful woman stands next to you in the bar and goes, "Hello, honey." It's been a long time since a woman did that to me, but, you know, that would be unusual for me. But, yeah, so don't be too sociable. Develop very good HR and security policies for your organization. Do a full ongoing background checks. Again, all of these are good tips and good advice. Again, you're professional people. I'm sure you're aware of these. Here's an interesting thought, though. This is interesting. Newcastle in England, a crime hub, no less. They had the highest rate of bike thefts, anywhere else in Europe. I mean, I don't know why, but an enormous number of bike thefts. And what they did, they designed this poster, and they put this poster in strategic places where the bikes were being stolen. Did you know that it reduced crime by 2/3 in 12 months? No cameras, No policemen, no guns, nothing. Just the poster, "We are watching you." Isn't that amazing? Think about that. Because it's not, security is not about security, it's about feeling secure. It's about perception. I work in Iceland quite a bit, and they had an old US military base in Iceland. And the base was abandoned, but they still had to have an American presence. So they had one guy, one armed guy. He probably had one bullet in his gun, okay? But as far as the base was concerned, it was secure, okay? Number one, the deep dark web, okay? The dark web is, and I've got a complete session at this at TechEd this year. So basically, everything that you see on the internet is up there at the top. The good ship Google sails on. Yes? Everything's nice. But underneath, of course, is where all the interesting stuff takes place. So, you know, we've got the government stuff. Oops, sorry. Come back. Da, 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 da. Yep. We've got the government stuff here. We've got undetected. You've got WikiLeaks. Hackers, of course. You've always had the porn sites at the top, but now we've got the really good stuff. I mean the illegal stuff. Sorry, I'm joking. So the dark web represents... Did you know the dark web is much, much larger than the internet? Much larger than the internet. It contains thousands and thousands of sites and thousands of pages that are unreferenced by traditional websites. But again, it's not all bad. In order to get access to the website, the dark web, you could try the Tor network. Now, the Tor network isn't designed for the dark web. It was designed, actually, to give people who are oppressed the ability to be anonymous on the internet. So it's a way of giving you anonymity on the internet. Unfortunately, it's been kind of twisted a little bit as well. So when we talk about this is kind of a good entry page. I'll show you this in a second. There's other web pages, things like where you can buy illegal drugs and unfortunately less savory things. Silk Road, of course, very famous website. So you need a... the Tor browser, for example, here. So I'm just going into the Tor browser here, and this creates a completely anonymous, secured network channel. So once I'm connected to the web, I had to put Bing in it somewhere. Wow, she's really loud. Okay. So I'm going to go on to the web. Of course, you got to read the disclaimer saying that you wouldn't do anything bad, of course, and I know that you wouldn't. But you can see here that I can now go in. So if I tried to search, for example, for the hidden wiki on Google, it wouldn't come up. But if I do this on the Tor network, I get access to this. And you can see in here that you can search for all kinds of nasty things. So, for example, if you want to buy drugs, guns, girls, just your average Saturday night in Kiev, I would imagine. financial services, Bitcoin. Yes, of course, that's the legitimate currency of the internet these days. But needless to say, you can get access to this stuff. And it's all available. Just a word of warning, folks. Be very, very careful what you search for here. It can lead you down some very dark paths, okay? And remember, not every juicy-looking website is a juicy-looking website. It could be government-controlled. So just be aware of that. So I'm going to make all of these, all of this material available to you for a price. Okay. So we have looked at the top 10. We have looked at number 10, the dark side of social networking. Number 9, we've done distributed denial of service attacks. Number 8, the cloud. Number 7, the hacktivist. Number 6, the Snowden effect. Number 5, state-sponsored cybercrime. Cyber war in at number 4. Attack of the phones, number 3. Number 2, weakest link. And number 1 is the dark web. You've been absolutely fabulous. I love you all. Hope you enjoy the conference, and I'll see you tomorrow for my Office 365 session. I'm Andy Malone. Thank you very much.